can't you? I'm Cricket Rumley. I'm one of the screenwriting instructors here. So excited to see you all tonight. And we're very fortunate to have, once again, a guest brought in by Tova Laiter, who's brought us a bunch of wonderful people. And tonight is Cassian Elwes, the producer of the film. And he is producer, deal maker, financier, considered one of the most important figures in independent cinema. We're very excited to have you here tonight. I'm going to read you some of the things from his bio, which include, Elwes is considered an expert in the field of arranging financing and distribution for independent films, having done so for 283 films during his tenure at William Morris Independent. Now, this is really important. For those of you who want to make films in Hollywood, you're probably going to be starting out on the independent level, so we're excited to have you here to talk about that tonight. I'm going to give you a quick list of some of the things that Mr. Elwes has been involved with. Financing and distribution of multiple films, including The Wettest County, directed by John Hillcoat, starring Shia LaBeouf and Tom Hardy. The Thriller Medallion, directed by Simon West, starring Nicolas Cage. And the upcoming thriller, The Paperboy, directed by Lee Daniels and starring Matthew McConaughey and Zac Efron. Now,
all movies that he just produced the last year that are not out yet.
Okay, and hopefully you'll be able to tell us a little bit more about those. I'm going to let you guys go ahead and get started, but I just want to say that one of the first films that I remember that he did, I was a teenager when it came out, Oxford Blues. I definitely remember that. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Okay, Cassian, nice to see you here. So, I remember when I came to see you at William Morris, when you were at William Morris, and I wanted you to help me with the film, and you said to me, the best way to get a film made here at the William Morris Independent is if you're a client here, if you have a client in the movie, and so on and so forth. So, why did William Morris pluck you and bring you into William Morris and Independent to start this whole division, and what was the agenda?
First of all, thank you guys very much for watching this movie. I've seen it a few times, and hopefully you guys haven't seen it before, but if you have, it's still as good the second time and the third time as it is the first time around. William Morris, in 1994, when I went there, had just brought over and merged with another small boutique agency called Triad. And the William Morris had been devastated because Stan Kamen, who was the head of the motion pictures for many years, had died from AIDS and all the clients had left. And so they merged with this very hot young agency at that time, Triad, and they put the guy that was in charge of Triad in charge of William Morris. His name was Arnold Rifkin. And Arnold Rifkin was trying to figure out how the heck he was going to go out and compete with CAA and ICM at that time. And he thought, well, maybe one of the things we could do is get into independent movies, and we could distinguish ourselves from everybody else. And we could say, we'll help independent films get made, and that way we'll get new clients to come over and say, you know, we've got an independent movie, and we'd like some help, and we would have somebody internally that would actually do it. It was all really just cosmetic. They didn't, in their opinion at that time, they didn't really think there was any money in independent films, and they certainly didn't think that we would ever really make any independent films. They just wanted to talk about it, and then they could get them into the client, you know, potential actors or directors into a deeper conversation about trying to sign them. And then they went about trying to find somebody to actually do it. They put one of their own agents in charge, a guy called Morgan Mason, lovely guy. His father was an all-time actor called James Mason. And after about 6 months, he said, I've had enough. I just got married to, the Go-Go's, Belinda Carlisle. And I'm, you know, she's rich, and I don't need to be an agent anymore. So he left. And so this whole big plan.
That happened to me.
This whole plan kind of was going awry, and they're like, quick, we need to find somebody else, some other sucker who's made independent films to come over here and pretend like he's going to make some independent films for us. And so they brought me over. They picked me out of, not obscurity, you know, I'd made like 30 movies already as an independent producer, but they were mostly very low budget stuff, action movies, exploitation movies. You know, I made some bigger movies, but nothing that I would say that was a great movie, or this was a great movie. And certainly, you know, what the agency was interested in was making prestigious movies, movies that could potentially win awards. And I wasn't making those kind of movies. So it was a big surprise to me, quite frankly, that they were interested in me. And they offered me the job. I had one interview with this guy. I showed up wearing what I'm wearing. They were all in suits. And so they called me up about half an hour later and said, the guy who was their kind of head of personnel said, they want to hire you. So here's the offer. And I was like, well, can I think about it? And they're like, well, don't think too long because there are other people who are interested in it. So I said, okay, so I called up my wife, and she said, you should do it. You know, you're missing your young kid's life, and you're running around making all these movies, and you're never spending any time at home with your family. And then I called my soon-to-be ex-business partner, who was a producer with me, who is a lunatic, who'd just gone through some very difficult psychological problems. And he said, oh, no, don't do it. And I knew I had to. And then I went over there thinking, okay, I'm going to go there for 2 years, and I'm going to get rid of all my financial problems, and I'm going to get rid of all my lawsuits, and I'm going to get them to introduce me to as many rich people as they can possibly find, and then I'll meet all the directors and I'll meet all the actors, and then in 2 years from now I'm going to leave and make my own movies again, but this time I'm going to know all these directors and know all these financiers. And the first movie was an art movie called Total Eclipse. I'm boring. We should go into the questions.
No.
Well, the first movie was called Total Eclipse, and it was David Thewlis and this relatively unknown kid, Leonardo DiCaprio, playing two gay poets in Paris. And I looked at the script and I was like, are you kidding? And with a woman, a very good director, a Polish woman called Agnieszka Holland. And I thought, okay, if I could raise the money for this, I could pretty much raise the money for anything. And so, and then I was trying to think, how could I benefit out of this? And I was like, I'd like to go to Europe and see my family. So I said to them, I need to go to Europe, to Paris, to meet all the people involved and to figure out how we're going to raise the money. I went to Paris and I met a lot of different, and I traveled around Europe quite a bit for about 3 weeks and met as many different financiers, you know, saying, I'm from William Morris, and I want to meet you and talk to you. And we ended up stringing the financing together for this movie with 9 different people. And and I came back to LA. They thought, okay, that's brilliant. Here's 20 more bad, you know, really difficult movies for you to work on. And the second picture was Slinglade, which was a young writer-director, Billy Bob Thornton. He was a TV writer, he wanted to direct, and he'd starred in a short of the movie called Some Call It Slinglade. And so I looked at that and I was like, oh my God. And then he came over and he started performing a bit of it. And I was like, oh my God. And how am I going to raise the money for this? And anyway, one thing led to another. I went to a company in New York called a shooting gallery who I'd been competing with when I was a producer, and decided I was going to make friends with them and try to engage them in making films with me. And they put up the $780,000 to make that movie. And when it was all done, and this is just kind of example of not probably the, this is the exception rather than the rule, but I was trying to think, how am I gonna sell the movie? Because I saw it and I thought it was really good, but a difficult movie, but really good. And so I thought, okay, I'm gonna have a screening of the movie. I'm gonna show it here in Hollywood and invite all the buyers, all the different studios that it would be, have been calling saying they want to see the film. I'm going to tell them all they can come and see it at exactly the same time on the same evening. And we rented a theater up on the Sunset 5 and invited everybody to come to see it. And the only person that couldn't come was Harvey Weinstein, who was in Paris working on, I don't even remember what movie he was working on. And I barely knew him, but at that time he was like the Wizard of Oz in independent films. And his office had called and said he's not going to be able to come to the screening, but he'd like to get a screener of the film. And so I thought, okay, you know, I mean, we want to get him involved in competing for this film, even if we don't necessarily think he'll buy it. We want other people. We want to give everybody a fair chance at this thing. And we got a screener of it, and I said to Larry Maestrich, who was the head of shooting gallery at that time, you got to get somebody, it's not that expensive, to get on the airplane and fly from New York to Paris with the screener, and you have to walk into his hotel suite or his hotel and hand it to his assistant at exactly the same time that the film starts screening in Los Angeles, which was like 5 o'clock in the morning in his time, which is insane, you know, or whatever it was, 3 o'clock in the morning. And somehow or other, the assistant screwed up, or maybe Weinstein bullied this poor guy, because he got to the hotel early and handed him the DVD before the movie had started here, an hour before. And so he finished watching it about halfway through the movie, and he called me up and go, okay, it's a piece of shit. How much are you going to sell it to me for? And I go, I don't know. I mean, the film hasn't finished. Nobody else had a chance to see it. Well, I don't give a shit about that. And so I said, okay, well, and I was sitting there and I was thinking, this is going to just ruin me now, because if I sell the movie to him before the movie's over and then all these people come out of the screening, I go, oh, sorry, we sold the movie already. This is going to be the end of my career. So, you know, it hasn't even barely started. Then I thought about it, okay. And he's on the phone going, come on, tell me, what do you want? And I go, you know what? I want $10 million for it. He goes, fuck you, you motherfucker, how dare you? You know what fucking type it is here? And you're giving me this shit over the phone at 3 o'clock in the morning? Are you fucking out of your mind? So so I said, well, you know, that's it. He goes, I'm going to get you out of that job. You'll be finished in 20 minutes from now. Just hang on, you motherfucker. So he calls my boss on a rip. He goes, yeah, dad, this motherfucker asked me for $10 million. Are you out of your mind? Fuck these people. And so I get a phone call from Arnold. He goes, listen, Cassie, you can't talk to him this way. You can't make these crazy kind of proposals to him. You know, he's very upset. You know, he's very important to us. He's a big buyer. We're doing Pulp Fiction with him. And, you know, we did Pulp Fiction with him. And we can't get him mad like this. And I go, look, you know, you brought me into this job. He goes, yeah, but I didn't bring you into the job to have you make an enemy of all the people that we want to be in business with. And I go, okay, but that being said, you did bring me into this job. So let me do my thing. If I screw this up, then fine, but at least empower me. If you end up making the deal with him, then what am I here for? You might as well be doing this. And he goes, well, I guess that's a good point. So I said, what do I do if he calls me again? I said, don't take the phone call, all right? Just don't take the phone call. He goes, well, this is really difficult. I said, it's not that difficult. Just tell him you're having a meeting or you're in with a client or whatever. Just don't take the phone call. Okay, fine. His assistant calls and says, you know, Harvey Weinstein's getting berserk. He called him 3 times now. I hasn't called him back yet. And so finally, the phone rings in my office. I go, yeah. He goes, I fucking hate you. You barely even know you, and I hate you already. And I go, okay. He goes, you know what? Fuck you. I'll pay the $10 million. But you know what? Fuck you. Hang up. And we did. We sold the movie to him for $10 million. Now, after that, the agency was like, oh, wow, this is a good business. We can, you know. And we can actually make money in this thing. This isn't just a vanity thing anymore. We can actually make money from this business. And the reason why the agencies had never been interested in independent films is because most independent films at that time, probably still now, cost $2 million, $3 million, $1 million, $5 million. And then you got, you know, what they would do is the producers would come along, like myself now, and say, okay, I'm making this movie only for $3 million, so we want Bruce Willis to be in it, but we can only pay him $1 million or $500,000. And when his real price was $5 million or $10 or $8 million, whatever his price was or whatever their price is on now. And then the agency would say, absolutely not, he's never going to do the film. Then they would be forced, if it was an important producer or director, to send the script finally to the client. And the client would read it and go, I love this part, I want to do it. Sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes they would. And then they'd be forced to make a deal for them for a fifth of what they normally made. So on a $5 million movie, the most you could probably get was about $500 to $1 million. And so the agency would make $50,000 to $100,000 and take the client off the market for a while they could be in a big movie at a studio and be making some real money. And it was just annoying to them to have to only make $50,000 on a stupid independent movie with their client tied up, or an important client tied up. So that's the reason why they all hated independent films. Nobody wanted to be involved in them. Nobody wanted to help any of them. Nobody wanted to get any of these films made. And what I did is I said, okay, look, here's the reality. Instead of just like putting the actor in the thing, we'll get the commission on that, fine. Sometimes we'll help pull the financing together and we'll charge the producer and we'll say, you know, if you want to get your movie made, I'll help you raise all the money, but I want you to pay me $100,000 to do it, like an executive producing fee. We're not allowed to take any credits because we're agents, but we can help you. So then that suddenly there was the new notion of a packaging fee in town for an independent movie, as opposed to packaging up to that point really only been in television. And then I said, beyond that, we can actually take the movie and tell them that we want to sell the American rights for the film. And we can say, look, we sold Sling Blade and we sold it for $10 million, so clearly we know what we're doing. We want 5% of that sale, or we want 7.5% of that sale. So we take a $5 million movie, half of the money comes in from foreign, we sell it for a couple of $100,000 and a couple of $1 million in the US, that's another $200,000. So we got 50 on the client, 100 to set it up, 200 to sell it. We just made $350,000. That's like booking an actor for $3.5 million in a movie, and that didn't take us too long to do any of it. And we could do like 10 or 15 of those a year, and it suddenly turned into a giant business for the agency. Like, everyone had an independent film that they were making. And right at that time, Pulp Fiction came out, which was the first time an independent film had made $100 million at the box office. I feel like I'm doing all the talking and I'm asking any questions. So it was a great time to be an agent doing independent films. We'd say, oh, we saw Sling Blade, we were involved in making Pulp Fiction, we did this, we did that, and then we were driving, so much business was coming to us that within 3 years, 4 years, all the other agencies were like, holy shit, we got to get into this business too. And now today, you'll see that every agency has an independent film packaging department. They're involved in exactly doing exactly what we set out to do, the same thing. They're packaging movies. They're getting packaging fees. They're selling the international rights in some cases now. That was an idea that I had later on, 5 or 6 years after I was in the job. I was there for 15 years, which was not just selling domestic, but we could sell the rights in Germany, or we could sell the rights in France, and we could get another fee for doing that too. And so I brought over a woman who was a big international sales executive to come and be my partner at William Morris, who now works at UTA. And we killed it, and I killed it for a long time at William Morris. And then 2 years ago, William Morris merged with Endeavor. And I thought, you know what, all those years, people kept saying to me, I can't believe that you're doing it, you know, for the agency, you should be doing it for yourself, you should be doing it for yourself. And I thought, stupidly probably now in retrospect, I'm going to see if I can try to do this myself. And all those movies that I worked on, I never got any credits. I'm not a producer on this movie. That's very nice that this lady said that I was. But in essence, I helped them make this movie happen. So when I talk about making a movie for the agency, I can kind of explain what it was that I was doing. I was taking the scripts, I was helping find the actors to be in it, I was helping find the money for it, which I think is the most important part of producing really, which is to finance it. And then on top of that, I was selling the distribution rights. So I was doing far more on these movies than the actual producers were. I mean, I'm not saying taking it away from them. They helped develop the script, they sat on the set, they sat in the editing rooms, they cut the movies, they helped develop them, they helped make them, the actual physical making of it. But the hardest part, in my opinion, of producing movies is to raising the money. It's impossible. And that's the area that is what we were involved in. And that's what we did, was raising money. And that's what I'm still doing. So these 14 movies or whatever it is that I've made since I left the agency, I did all the financing arrangements for those movies. I came up with the formula of how we were going to do it. I went out and executed it. I found the equity financiers that came in, the rich kids, the rich ladies, the rich whatever, to come in and put the difficult money into the movie. And then when the movies were done, I went out and arranged the distribution for those films. And I've worked alongside all the agencies now, which is far better for me now, because at William Morris, I could only work on all the films that were coming through William Morris and our clients. And now I can work with CAA, I can work with ICM, I can work with UTA, I can work with WME, I can work with them all. And they all know me, and they know that if I say, okay, I'm gonna raise the money for that, there's a pretty good chance that I am. So that's kind of in a nutshell what I'm doing. And I guess we veered off Half Nelson. But that's,
so how did you do it for Half Nelson? Well, who was the client there? Because Ryan was actually IFN.
Yeah, so on that one, my former assistant, who's now an agent at WME called Craig Estelle, had come in and was badgering me in the office about these two young writer-directors that he'd signed called Anna Bowden and Brian Fleck. And he kept saying, they're great, they're so talented, they hadn't really made a movie. I think he'd seen the short that they made. And it was kind of at that point, I was trying to work on bigger movies with bigger directors and bigger packages. So, you know, the bigger the movie, the more money I could make out of it, the more the agency could. You know, we were under pressure all the time from the agency to make more money each year than the year before. So he was badgering me, and he goes, you know, it's going to be a great movie, and you got to be involved in this. You have to do a casting. You have to. It's your kind of movie. And, you know, I'm kind of a sucker, actually, really, when it comes down to it. And you look through all the films that I worked through over the years. You know, I've worked on some big movies, some really big movies. I've worked on lots of movies that have big movie stars, that made big money, that were very successful. But also, in between, are tons of little tiny movies that I personally have a deep affinity for, and I love young filmmakers. I love working with young filmmakers. I love being involved in their first movies, their second movies. I love thinking about, because they're challenging. You know, when you get to a certain point in your life, you know, and this is probably says something about my own psychology, I was always looking for new challenges to things that were difficult. And people would come to me and say, hey, there's this movie, they've been trying to make it for years. And I go, immediately, it would be like the bull with the red flag. Oh my God, I could do something that nobody else could do, you know? And so he also knew that that was my own how to get to me, which is, hey, and you know they're going to get Ryan Gosling to be in the movie. And I you know, love Ryan Gosling. I worked on a movie called The United States of Leland, which was an earlier picture of his. And I worked a little bit on The Believer. And I was just a big fan of his, always. And so I thought, okay, here's the first-time directors. We represent them. Ryan Gosling's going to be in it. How much is the movie going to cost? $750,000. You know, nobody wants to make these kind of movies, but we'll figure it out. And in the end, the money came from a lot of young private investors and people that weren't really in the movie business. Then we took the movie. Then, of course, the first thing is you think, okay, we're going to bring the movie to Sundance. It's a perfect movie for Sundance. We're going to take it there. And we had a hard time, actually, getting the movie into the film festival. They thought it was a little weird and offbeat. And then they thought about it, and they came back to us a couple of weeks later and said, okay, fine, we'll play the film. And we showed the movie there, and we got all the distributors to come in and sit in the screening room in Sundance at the first screening to come and see it. And then, you know, what we would do usually, myself and my partner at that time, Rena Ronson, is that we'd stay outside in the lobby to see if anybody walked out of the film, just so we'd have it in our notes, like who hated it, and clearly not going to bother calling them to see what they thought. And we sat in the lobby of that movie, and a few people did walk out of it, you know, but the obvious ones, like studio people, you know, clearly they're not going to do this kind of a movie. And then we would we'd watch at the end, see what, when people came out in the lobby, see whether they were chattering about it or whether they were looking at the program to see what the next movie was going to be. So we'd get a kind of feel for whether they liked it or not. We'd go inside and see people asking questions like this, but, you know, much bigger audience, asking the Q&A and whether people said we liked it, we hated it, or whatever. And then we left and we thought, okay, we got to wait for about half an hour and see if anybody calls us and say they loved it, which is what you're praying for as an agent. It's like at least two of them to call, because if you got two, you can torture both of them that there are 40 people trying to buy it from both of them. If you only have one person that wants to buy it, you're really in trouble, because then you got to try to convince them that there are 40 other people, and that meanwhile, all their junior executives are calling all their friends who work at all the other junior executives at all the other studios going, we're not buying it, right? It's awful, it's rubbish, you're not buying it either, right? We're not gonna have to compete on this one. And they all chatter with each other. And then they go straight onto their Blackberries and they check blogs to see if any of the people that were in the screening in the theater are blogging already about it and saying, oh, it's awful, it's rubbish, it's great, it's this, it's that. So we're checking the blogs quickly too to see what the general feeling is for the movie. And we then started calling around, and without fail, all of them were like, no. You know, he's so good, Ryan Gosling, but, you know, Cassian, you know what's in the movie? I go, yeah, no, I've seen the movie. I know what's in the movie. Well, you know, he does drugs in the film, and he's a teacher, and, you know, he's got a relationship maybe with an underage African-American girl. It's really not the kind of thing that I think I could recommend to my boss. So, okay. And we had a number of those conversations with people. And then Rena and I are looking at each other going, oh, my God. Because when we saw this movie at William Morris, you know, a few weeks before, we're like, oh, my God, this is so brilliant. This is so brilliant. This is like, it was so much better than we even thought it was going to be. And the movie's so great. And these directors are brilliant. And Ryan Gosling is brilliant in the film. And we were just rubbing our hands with glee before we got some of this, how much we were going to sell it for. And then all of a sudden, like, nobody wants the movie. Then, then it turned out that there were two companies that were interested in the film. One was the newly constituted version of Miramax after Harvey Weinstein had left. They'd brought in a guy called Daniel Batzik, who was very nice, to run the company for them. And he wasn't there in Sundance, the new boss, but his number two guy, a guy called Peter Lawson, had seen the movie in the screening and said, it's brilliant, and called up his boss and said, we have to buy this movie, this is so for us. And this is like a perfect independent movie. And then the other company was a company called Think Films, which was a guy called Mark Irwin, who was out of Canada. And they were interested, but they had no money. And, you know, and our first thing always is agents like, oh, they got no money. So they were just, because all you're thinking about, which is so sad, really, in retrospect, but all you're thinking about is how much money you're going to make on any of this stuff, you know? And so this is a fair warning to all of you young budding filmmakers or whatever, that all your agents think about is one thing only, is how much money they're going to make out of you. So we're thinking that, Think Films has no money, but Miramax has money. He's new in charge, and I'm sure they gave him a new fat checkbook to play with. We're going to get him to do it. So we bring him over. He hasn't seen the movie, but we bring out over all his people, and this is the next day, to sit in our suite. And the way we would do it is we would bring the distributors that were interested in the film to come and sit with the filmmakers. And while they were pitching the filmmaker on why they should have it, they're basically, while they're selling the filmmaker, this was the psychology that we figured out after a while, that while they're selling the filmmaker on why they should be the distributor of the film, they're actually selling themselves, because they're starting to say, yeah, we could do this, and we could do that, and we could get into this cinema. And every time they say, come up with another idea, we're writing down like $25,000 more, $25,000. It's not quite as crass as that, but it's in that area. And then we brought over Think Films, and then they're going, look, we don't really have any money, but we would be perfect for it. And we're writing on our notes, no, no, no. So then the guys who are the financiers, we get them finally to make us an offer, both of these companies. We send them away. We tell them other people want it, but they really like you too, so we need an offer. They make the offers, which are pretty low, but they're fine, because the Think Film offer is really low. But the Miramax offer is pretty good. And the guy who's one of the producers on the movie, who will remain nameless, he's like, the investors are not going to go for that deal from Miramax. You know, we can't sell the foreign for more than X number of dollars, even if we have Miramax distributing. And we're like, you're so wrong. If you got Miramax on their name just on the front of it, you get $1 million from foreign, you'll get way out of this film. I don't know, but let me call the finance. And he calls the finance, and the finance is going, well, what do you think? And this guy's like, literally like a tower of jelly going, I don't know. And we're in the background going, do it, do it, do it. And he's like, he hangs up and he says, he won't do it. We're like, really? No, he wants to think about it tonight and then we'll make a decision tomorrow morning. We're like, no, 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 no. You got to make a decision right now, because if you don't make a decision right now, you never know what could happen. So he goes, no, that's the decision, Cassian. We're going to wait on it tonight, and we're going to make a decision tomorrow. I go, your lawyers are here, okay? And I want to say in front of all your lawyers, this is the dumbest move I've ever, because one day your lawyers will actually back me up and say, Cassian did in fact say that was the dumbest decision that you've ever made. And when all your investors come back and say, how did this ever happen? At least the lawyers will say, you know what, Cassian recommended that you didn't do this. But look, if that's what your decision is. That night, the guy who is the Daniel Batzik flies in to Sundance, because he's going to take control of the situation now and decide, you know, what the deal's going to finally be. And he he talks to them and he goes, well, let just give me a brief overview, because I haven't seen the film, of exactly what it's about. He goes, well, it's about a teacher and, you know, maybe on drugs, and he's got this relationship with this 14-year-old black girl, and, you know, it's not really a relationship, but it's something weird going on between them, and you know, it's really cool, though. It's got great music in it. He goes, hold on one second. Who's the parent company of this company that we all work for? He goes, Disney. He goes, do you think Disney's going to say this is a great idea, that the first movie that we bought out of the box is about a teacher who's a drug addict who has a relationship with an African-American girl who's 14? Are you out of your mind? Got fired immediately. So the next morning they call and say, we're withdrawing our offer. And I was like, oh, God. So now we only have one studio left. This is Think Films. And the guys who are financing it go, how did this happen? I go, check with your lawyers. They'll remind you how this happened. Because they would have closed the night before. They would have signed the contract, and it would have been all way, way too late. Because the way we operated, the moment they made the deal, we type up the piece of paper immediately and shove it in front of them and make them sign it, you know? When I first started it, I would actually sit in the restaurants where we make the deals and get out of, well, people say on napkins. I never made a deal on a napkin, because a napkin could be destroyed as evidence later on. But I would get, and it was very hard to Xerox a napkin, but you could Xerox a piece of paper. So I would get pieces of paper and write the stuff out longhand and go, okay, you've agreed to pay $3 million and you'll get $1 million of it next week, and then $2 million when we deliver the film, and you will release it in 30 cinemas, and you will pay the residuals, and you will, and go through the whole list and write it out in longhand and then put it in front of the guy and go, that's what we just talked about, right? And he goes, yeah. Kind of have my lawyer look at it. Oh, no, there's no point. The lawyers will take this piece of paper later and they'll create a contract out of this, and then it's all fine. This is just you and I just talking and just agreeing to something. And the guys from the distribution companies, they later on they got a bit smarter about this, but they would sign those things. I still have quite a few of those things as copies of them. Because then I'd hand them to my lawyer and say, so they signed it and I signed it, so that's a contract, right? And they go, oh, absolutely, that's a contract. So we would then shove these pieces of paper in front of people, and they would show them to their lawyers, and then they'd haggle for a few hours, and then they'd come back and make a few changes, and we had a computer there in Sunhouse, so we'd make the changes too. So we would have got Miramax to sign it that night. I guess that's the point I was going to say. So the next day we only have one company, it's Think Films. And so the guy is now like, okay, this is devastating. He has to call his investor and say, look, in fact, now we're only going to get one quarter of what we were going to get last night from these other people. And I said, look, I think what you should do is you should say, we're going to make a different kind of a deal for this movie. You know, to spin it to him in a different way. Just say, look, we've decided that, in fact, the film is so fabulous, we're going to take no money for it whatsoever. And we're going to make a distribution deal with it which essentially means that instead of the studio charging 25% distribution fee on all of it except for the home video, and then on home video DVDs, they'd give you a royalty of 25%, which is one of the greatest rip-offs that any of the studios can possibly do. When you guys hear this later on in your lives and you hear royalties, just know that that is one of the greatest scams in this business, because a royalty means that for a 25% royalty on a DVD means that every dollar that they collect on the DVD, they take 25 cents of it and they put it on the piece of paper that shows where they have to get all the money back. They paid you $2 million for the film. I'm just making this up. They spent $2 million to release it. They spent $4 million on the movie. Primarily, independent films do extremely well on DVDs and pay television and all the other areas, but not so well in the movie theaters. Usually they lose their P&A. Usually it's just their prints and advertising money. Usually they're just using that to just actually advertise the title so they can do extremely well later on their DVDs. And then they give you a DVD royalty, which means a 25% royalty. So they take the dollar, every dollar that came from the poor consumer that bought that DVD, they take 25 cents of it and they write it down towards the $4 million that they've spent on the film. And then so let's say that the movie actually sold $4 million worth of DVDs. They take $1 million of that and they write it down on the $4 million that they have to recoup, the $2 million they paid you and the $2 million that they spent on it. And the other $3 million straight in the pocket. It's a beautiful deal. It's one of the greatest deals in the world. for the studios. And that's why the studios do so well, is because they make all their money in the ancillary area. And so I said, look, we're going to come up with this very snazzy deal. What we're going to do is, instead of taking any money whatsoever, we'll make a distribution deal with this company, Think Films, and we're going to cut the distribution fee to very small. We're going to get it to like 10 or 12%. And then what we're going to do is we're going to get them to agree that they're going to put 100% of all the DVD money in, 100% of all the, and only take a 12%, 12.5% distribution fee on that. So in fact, on every DVD, we're going to get 87.5 cents from each sale and put that towards the bottom line. And that's a good deal, because you can recoup pretty quickly, and particularly if they haven't paid you anything, you can get ahead of the game pretty fast. At least that's what we were selling to the investors, like, make that deal, because at least you can go to the investor and say, this is the crazy deal that Cassian and Rena have come up with, and it's brilliant, because in 5 months from now, we could make like 3 million instead of the 200 we're being offered. And I said, that just defers the problem for another 6 months. Meanwhile, you guys will be off to another movie. I'll be off to another movie. Just let somebody else worry about this. I'm sorry to say all this stuff, because it's unfortunately all the truth, but this is how you think, you know? And so we made a distribution deal with Think Films on this movie. They made a fortune on it. They made it, the Ryan Gosling was nominated for Academy Award. The guy who was the head of the studio spent, the head of distribution, spent far too much money on the promotion and campaign for the Oscars. But in fact, they owed, you know, the producers about $1 million on it, which was, you know, they've been offered, I think, $250,000, so it's four times what the original offer was. So in fact, the whole thing turned out very well. The postscript of the whole story is that then, after they paid like half the money, Think Films was taken over by a total crook called David Bergstein, who then ripped off the entire company, stole everything, and then put it in bankruptcy, and they never got the rest of the money. So that's a sad ending to that story. But this film sits in this kind of limbo now of bankruptcy and kind of insanity, and will end up in the hands of who knows who eventually.
Students, you want to ask questions? If you want to ask a question, line up behind the microphone over there.
Sorry, I completely digressed into this whole area.
It was so entertaining, and it explained everything. I wish we will continue very soon to ask a question. Okay, who's going?
Is that everyone's listening in total shock now about how these things work? Do you still want to make movies?
Hi, my name is Belle Angel, and I'm in the MFA Screenwriters Program. But I'm curious to find out, I know you briefly elaborated on your job with William Morris Agency, but I would like to know, how did you get there? I mean, what's your educational background and training? Because obviously...
Okay, I have to admit right up front that I was born into this business. When I was about 9 years old, my mother, I grew up in London, as you can tell from my accent, I'm actually originally English, and my mother suddenly, who was divorced and was bringing out three young boys, suddenly announced to us one day when I was about 9 years old that she was dating an American movie producer who happened to be in London making a movie there. And then suddenly we had this crazy Brooklyn kind of, you know, Tova knew him quite well, guy who was suddenly in our life. And so, you know, we started out kind of in this pretty modest English upbringing. And next thing we knew, we were staying at the Beverly Hills Hotel, and we were meeting like Elizabeth Taylor, and we were like flying around going to movie sets, and we were like the kids of the guy who's the big time Hollywood producer. And so throughout my childhood, you know, my teen years, this is all I wanted to do. I wanted to, one day I'm going to grow up and I'm going to be just like Elliot. I'm going to get on the phone and scream at people and be unpleasant. And that's going to be great, which actually I'm not. I'm actually very calm now.
I spent one weekend in Malibu when Elliot was visiting a producer, Marty Elfin.
Right.
And Elliot Kastner, who is his father, was like on the phone for the entire weekend. Even when he went to the bathroom, he took the phone with him.
Right.
So
no, he
just talked to people around the clock. But he got amazing movies made.
And he, you know, he when he met my mom, he decided he was going to stay and live in England to be with her, and start his own family, which I have a little brother and sister. And so he then came up with this idea of living in London, even though he was this crazy kind of New York Hollywood producer, that he could go around and find rich people in Europe and get them to put money into movies. So apart from just making the films with the studios here, he was making a whole bunch of other films in Europe with private money. So I kind of grew up in that idea too, that you didn't have to work with the studios in America to make films. And that's what led me in a way into where I am now. The first answer is, I dropped out of college when I was 1 year into it because I was desperate to be a movie producer, and I was studying Middle Eastern history, which was so nothing to do with what I wanted to do. And they found out at the school that I was like not really even really studying that hard, and they tossed me out. My parents were extremely upset, and I ran away basically, and I got a job without telling them on a movie that shot in the British Honduras called The Dogs of War. And I got a job as like the lowest of the low on the film. And they paid me $300 a week and per diem, which was like another $100 a week. And we were in the British Honduras where I swear there was nothing to spend the money on. There was like literally nothing. We'd get our meals from the film and then we'd go home. And then if we spent $2 on a dinner, that was a lot of money there because nobody, everyone was like so impoverished. There was nothing to, you know, everything was so cheap. And so when I came back to LA, I had like $5,000 on me. And I thought, okay, I'm gonna stay in Los Angeles until the 5,000 runs out and see if I can get a real job here. And I got a job working for a company called Filmways. It's not around anymore. And I worked for them for about 2 years. And while I was there, I was basically an assistant to the guy who was the head of production. And they were kind of, the company was sort of going out of business. It was in a weird place. It was a distribution company, a small company. I was trying to think, it would be like the equivalent of Magnolia now, but they were having a lot of, but they weren't doing the kind of VODs and all the things that are going on these days with distribution, but they were a small company. And they weren't making enough movies to feed the guys who were running the distribution company. They're like, come on, where's the movies? We need to put more movies out. So I went to my boss at that time, at the ripe old age of 22, and said, listen, you know what we should do is, I bet you there's tons of movies out there that don't have distribution, and we should just call them up, like cold call them, and see if we could maybe buy a couple of these movies and we can put them out ourselves. And he goes, okay, that's your new job. So I had this job that was fantastic, where I would sit there, and I was getting paid to do the thing that I love the most, which is to watch movies every day and look at these things. And most of them were awful. I mean, when I think back at some of the films I saw, they were just mind-bogglingly bad. But some of them were really good. And what I would do then afterwards is that the guy who was the producer of the film would come and be so happy that the guy from the studio was going to engage him in a conversation, which was me, about the movie, that he would spill his guts immediately. And I would say, so, God, that movie was really great, even though I thought it was terrible. And I go, I don't know if it's for us, but I mean, God, how did you raise all the money for it? And they would just spin to me how they were doing it. So I was in my head, I was like, oh my God, that's how you raise money for a movie. That's how you get the money for, you know, from the money from the government in Australia and the money from the government in Germany. And so in a way, they were actually teaching me how to finance an independent movie by me just watching their movies and saying, forget it. And and I saw some great movies. I saw Mad Max, you know, for the first time there. And and I said to my bosses, oh, this is a great movie. I saw it's an action movie. It's set in Australia. And there's this guy, young guy, what's his name? I think his name is Mel Gibson. They're like, oh, I know. We know who that is. I know the movie's so great. No. That'll never work. Nobody wants to see Australians in films. So Time Bandits, I really pushed that so hard. I was like, this movie's fantastic. And the guy, I know all these people. I grew up with the Monty Python people. And this is going to be huge. They're like, no. You just have no idea what really works in this country. And they would buy these movies then later on. I was like, are you kidding? Why are you buying that? Anyway, that company went out of business. But that's kind of how I got started thinking about how to raise money for independent films. So when that company folded at the ripe old age of 23, I was out of a job. And I was sitting in my apartment here in Beverly Hills. And by that point, Beverly Hills in West Hollywood. And by that point, I had reinvigorated my relationship with my parents. And my stepfather, who was very fond of calling me an asshole when I was a kid, and he was like, you really are an asshole. I can't believe you don't have a job anymore. And blah, blah, blah. So he says to me, listen, then one day, my mother into seats with him. I called her up and I said, you can't let him just keep berating me like this. And I do want to make films. I would like to be involved in the film business. You know, he is making lots of movies. Can you somehow or other talk to him and like calm him down and see if there's any way that I could talk to him in a serious way about maybe making a film with him that he could actually teach me how he does it? And she goes, all right, let me talk to him. And then, a couple of days later, he calls out and goes, oh, hey, asshole. I go, yeah. He goes, listen, why don't you come over to the Beverly Hills Hotel and let's have a little conversation. So I go over there. He goes, okay, so you got any ideas for a movie? Anything in that head of yours? I go, I saw this movie called Fast Times at Ridgemont High. Yeah, what is it about? And I proceed telling the story. And he goes, okay, so? So I go, well, there's this great character in it where this guy, played by Sean Penn, he's like a kind of surfer dude who's stoned all the time. And I was thinking we could do like a fish out of water story where we take that guy, that character, and we put him in an English college. So instead he goes from high school to an English college. What would that be like? It would be so funny to have this American surfer in an English college. It's not a bad idea. Yeah, I like that idea. And so he calls up a friend of his who's a writer who he'd gotten friendly with. And I found out later how he got friendly with him. This guy had been breaking into his office on the studio lot every night to use the typewriter in his office because he didn't have any money. And so he would write the pages on longhand during the day and then break into my stepfather's office at night and type it up on his typewriters. And then one day, Elliot caught him, I don't know how, at like 4 o'clock in the morning, he left something in the office and he was desperate for it. And he walked in and there's this guy like typing away. And of course, instead of calling security, they ended up becoming buddies because he was like so impressed that this guy was using his office that way. And so he called him up and he said, listen, Bob, I got a great idea for a movie. Of course, Elliot took full credit for it. I got a great idea for a movie and this is what it is. And it's about a guy who goes to Oxford University and he cons his way in and he's kind of a stoner kind of surfer kid from Malibu. And Bob goes, oh, that's a great idea. I could write that. He goes, listen, I'll let you direct that picture, but I'm not going to pay you anything for the script, but I will let you come on over and use the office during the day. And so then Elliot says, okay, we got to write a writer-director for this movie now. And it's going to be Bob. And okay. So he goes, listen, let me just tell you one thing, though. He's terribly lazy. And I go, really? Yeah. Well, when you meet him, you'll see. So I met this guy. He's like 400 pounds. He's like huge. And I was thinking to myself, how the heck is he even getting... have the stamina to like last on the set as the director of the movie, but for me to question this. Because so then he calls me up and he goes, so did you meet Bob? I go, yeah, I met Bob. You see, I just think he's kind of lazy. So this is what you're gonna have to do. You're gonna have to go around every single day to his apartment get him in the car, drive him over to the office and watch him while he actually types the script up, because I'm telling you, he'll never finish it. So which I did. And then after a while, Bob was like, look, do we really have to go to the office? Can't I just stay in the apartment? And so then Elliot would call up and go, how many pages did you do? I go, I don't know, he's done like 3 pages. And Bob was like lying, because he'd only done like 1. So then finally, we ended up like renting another apartment for him, which I had to stand guard outside every day to make sure that Bob was delivering the 5 pages a day that he promised. And this poor guy was working for nothing on the promise that he was going to be the director of it. And he finally finished the script. And we started talking about how we were going to make it. And Bob had written the part not as a stoner, but more as just a good-looking American kid, because he kept saying to me, listen, we can't get Sean Penn, and it's going to be so hard. Let's just get a good-looking guy, and we'll put him in it. And Elliot goes, oh, I know who I'm going to get. I met this kid in a restaurant last night, and he's the star of the picture. And I go, who? He goes, well, you're going to laugh when I tell you. I go, no, tell me. He's called Tyrone Power Jr. And I go, what? He goes, well, when I was a kid, all those movies that I used to go and see, the Tyrone Power starred in all of them. He was the biggest star in Hollywood. It's my dream. His kid is going to star in my movie, my film. It's going to be Tyrone Power Jr. I go, well, Elliot, I mean, can he act? It doesn't matter. He's got the genes. I tell Bob, Bob's like, forget it. And I said, well, you got to take the meeting with him anyway. And so we take the meeting and he goes, he can't, we taped it and we showed it. He's like, the guy can't act. And meanwhile, I had seen a movie called Class with Andrew McCarthy and Rob Lowe. And I thought Rob was so good looking, he kind of stole the whole movie. And he wasn't a great actor, but he was just such a star. And so I said to Elliot, there's this guy called Rob Lowe, we got to get him. Okay, how much do we have to pay him? I go, I don't know, he's kind of getting hot now. I called his agent, and he wants $250,000. He says, okay, offer him 25. What? Goes, you know, well, don't even tell him what we're offering. Just tell him we're offering him the movie. And then if he likes the script, then we'll give him the bad news then. So he reads the script and he loves it, wants to do it, which I'm like amazed because this guy, everyone's chasing him. And we're getting off the movie here. We're getting on Ox Blues. I can't believe we're talking about this. Anyway.
Well, you learn how to make, how those movies get made. It doesn't matter what they're called, right?
Right.
So Rob Lowe read the script. Then we told him it was $50,000. He went bonkers. He didn't want to do the movie anymore. And then about 2 weeks later, he called up and said, you know what? We can't get any more money out of Elliot and Cassian, but we love this script and his managers and agents. And they signed him up for our movie. And we got the movie. We made the movie.
Where
do
you get the money? I'm always interested. Where do you get
the money? Well, this is not what I suggest that you do, okay? But I'll just tell you how we did it. So we don't have any money, but we fly. Elliot has some money. He has like a couple of $100,000 handy at that point. So we fly Bob over to London, and we hire a casting director, and we start budgeting the film, and we start pretending that we're going to start making this movie. And we lucked out on a couple of things. You know, one of my best friend's ex-wife was married at that time. She was caught driving down Doheny in the wrong direction. And when the police pulled her over, they found 19 substances inside her. And the judge said, instead of going to jail, I'm ordering you into rehab immediately. And so she went to rehab. And in rehab, then they went to AA after the rehab. And in rehab, in AA, she wanted to be an actress, so she met so many actors and actresses at that AA. And then next thing I know, all these actors and actresses are like hanging out at their house, kind of like talking about how they're getting sober and they're all gonna, you know, really start working now like crazy. And all these actors, and then she joins their acting class that they're all in, which was a woman at that time called Peggy Fury, who's not alive anymore. And all these actors that were all her friends, that were hanging out at the house all the time, that were all getting sober, were Jimmy Spader and Eric Stoltz, and you name it, every young movie star in Hollywood was going to this acting class, and they were coming around to her house at nighttime and partying, but you know, on Coca-Colas. And so I met Ally Sheedy there because she was dating Eric Stoltz. And right before I left for England, we talked about I was going off to make this movie. I was so proud. It was my first movie. I'm going to produce this movie. And, you know, even though we didn't really have the money, we were just acting like we were, you know, it was like, just tell everyone we got the money. And so I said, I'm going to London next week to go make this movie. And it's called Ops of Blues. And Rob Lowe's going to be in it. And they were like, oh, okay, yeah, that sounds good. And so then two nights before I left to go to London, I got a phone call like at 3 o'clock in the morning. There's this girl crying on the phone, and I go, who is this? And she goes, it's Ally. And I go, hi, Ally, how are you? And she goes, I just broke up with Eric, and he's just such an asshole, and I just want to get away as far away from him as I possibly can. He's just awful, awful, awful guy. And so I was like, okay. She goes, listen, you know, you were talking about that movie that you're going to make in England with Rob, and I go, yeah, can I come and be in it? I mean, I'll just be like even a small part. I'll just walk on. I just need to get away from this guy. Get away from this guy. Please bring me to London. Now, she was an up-and-coming young actress, she'd just done a movie called War Games that hadn't come out yet. So I was like...
That was a big studio movie.
Yeah. So I was like, sure, absolutely. And I called Elliot the next day. I go, Elliot, you're never going to believe the lie. Ally Sheedy's going to play a small part in this movie. He goes, but she's so wrong for the princess, you know, that's supposed to be like Lady Di, an English guy. I know, but we're going to change one of the other parts, one of the guy roles into a woman, and we'll make it her instead, you know. And then Bob had to kind of come up very quickly, which was never quick with him, of how to create the guy role into the female role of the cox that is sitting on the front of the boat saying, row harder, and then fake a kind of romance with her at the very end, because that was never in the script, and fake this whole part. And she read it and was like, oh, I just love it. It's so clever. I'm coming. And she just, of course, was desperate to get away from Eric. And So then,
did she
anyway.
Put money up for the film?
No.
She
then did. We get to London, and now the line producer who Elliot's hired to make the movie keeps saying to me, you know, Elliot's talking, and he's talking about, you know, none of the money's shown up for the movie yet. I said, so what's the budget of the film going to be? He goes, $1 million. It's going to cost $1 million. It was about £600,000 that we're going to make the movie for. And he's given us like £100,000, but, you know, we haven't got the rest of the money. The rest of the money's there, right? And I go, oh, yeah, of course it is, of course it is. And then he basically starts bullshitting all the people and we start hiring everybody to be on this. This is not how you should make a movie, by the way. And we start hiring everybody. And on the first day of shooting, I'll never forget, first day of shooting, the guy comes to me, the line producer, and goes, okay, look, everyone's going to walk this week when they figure out there's, like, no money, and I can't get Elliot on the telephone, and it's like, this is a disaster, and this whole film's going to blow up. And I, you know, I'm, like, sitting there and getting the phone calls from Bob, oh, today's shooting was so great, the first day was so exciting, and Rob called me up, and this is so great, isn't it? How great is this? So much fun to all be here in Oxford. And then I'm, like, sitting there going, there's no money for this movie. And then the phone rings, like totally out of the blue. And they go, is this Cassian? And I go, yeah. Hold the line for Frank Yablans. And so I know of this guy. I don't know him. And I get on the phone and goes, hey, Cass.
He's chairman of Paramount, okay?
Well, at that time, he was the chairman of MGM. And what had happened was that morning, War Games had come out that weekend, and now it was the Monday. And they were sitting around, and they were so happy with each other at the studio because they finally had a hit with this War Games. So it was a big surprise. It was Matthew Broderick and Ali Sheedy. And they're sitting around and going, okay, we got to put Ali Sheedy into another movie. We got to get her into another film. Where is she? And they go, oh, she's making a movie already. What movie? She's shooting this little, I don't know, we just checked our records, and she's shooting some tiny little film in England called Oxford Blues. What's it about? It's about a guy who like, tries to get into Oxford University and he meets a girl and she's in it. Well, that sounds great. Who owns that movie? Which studio is making it? No, it says here that it's totally independent. Like, there's not a studio. He goes, okay, get them on the phone. So then they finally track me down to my room in Oxford. And this is late at night and it's early in the morning here. And he goes, hold the line for Frank Yablans. And we get on the phone. I go, hello? He goes, is this Cassian? I go, yeah. He goes, tell me about this picture you're making in London right now. I go, well, this is Rob Lowe. I know who he is. He's, you know, we're going to do another movie with him. I go, okay. And is Ali Sheedy in it? I go, yeah. What kind of part does she have? I go, so she's, you know, one of the female leads. Well, what do you mean one of? I go, well, you know, she's her, and then there's another girl. The girl that kind of plays like the Lady Di character. He goes, uh-huh. Are you guys looking for distribution in America? I go, yeah. He goes, how much do you want for it? I go, and by this point, I've been fairly well trained by Elliot to say, you need to talk to my stepfather about that because I'm not really in charge of the money. Well, we want to buy it. Who's your stepfather? I goes, Elliot Kastner. Elliot Kastner? Oh, fuck. So then I didn't hear any more about it. But then the guy who was the line producer on the film told me about 2 days later. He says, you know, the money showed up for the film. So everything's good. It's all good. I talked to Elliot. Money's been wired in. It's going to be here. There's no problem. I go, oh my, wow, that's great. So I call Elliot, you know, we're talking at the end of the week. I said, whatever happened with Frank and Brands? I'll tell you later, it wasn't a bad conversation. I go, okay. Way later, after the film was done, I was here in Los Angeles about 3 weeks after we wrapped. And by that point, we knew, we'd heard, because it was all over Hollywood and it was in the trades, that MGM had bought the film for America, for the US rights for it. And I finally said to Elliot, so, how much do you sell the movie for? Expecting, say, you know, 1 million, 2 million. He said, $6.5 million. I go, just for America? He goes, yeah. It's actually 7 million, but they haven't paid me the last 500 yet. I go, oh. So I said, Elliot, you know, you know how much I made on the movie, right? He goes, yeah, you made $25,000. You're damn lucky you did. I go, well, tonight, you know, I am one of the producers with you. Shouldn't I get, like, part of the profits of this film? Dead silence. No. I go, why? He goes, well, because if you made any real money now, you'd never have any appreciation of it later. I go, oh, that's good logic. And anyway,
all that money goes to your mother. So you talk to her about it. I'm like, oh, okay, then for sure I'm not going to get a dollar of this. So anyway, that's kind of how that movie got made. That's not how you should make movies.
Okay. Thank you for that background.
Boy, I can't stop talking.
What if you don't have that kind of connection? I mean, is there a book? I mean, is there some sort of
My advice now, like, everyone asks me now the same questions. Like, yeah. It's always the same thing. How do I get started? What do I do? I got a script. What do I do? Here's what I would say. Find somebody who does know what they're doing. Find somebody that has produced a movie before. Find somebody who's financed a movie before. Find somebody who you could create a relationship with. Then, because in my opinion, and this is what I tell everybody always, it's much better to own half of a movie with somebody and get a film made than to own 100% of it and never make it. So even if you don't make any money on the first movie, it doesn't matter, because it's all about making movies. This town is about one thing only. All the agents, and all the managers, and all the people that make films only care about one thing. Where's the money, and who's making movies? How do I get my movie made? Do they have the money? Do they have access to the money? Can they get their films made? You're only really, and then this is a great truism, and I'm sure it's in many books, you're only as good as the last movie you made. Well, if you've never made any movies, you're no good at all to anybody, quite frankly. So you've got to be in the stream of things. You've got to be making films. And even if that means making a film for $10,000, or making a film for $50,000, or making a film for $250,000, or making a movie for $1 million, if you can't figure out how to make it in the mainstream of Hollywood, if you can't figure out how to get the money from, like, legitimate sources, go get them from the family, the friends of the friends. Movies can be made for anything. That's the beauty of this town. The beauty of the technology now, the beauty of these digital cameras, is that you don't need a light. You could use one light and light me with that digital camera, and you can set up a scene, and you can shoot a scene right here. And you can take that DVD later on to post-production facility, and you can fiddle around with it and make the lighting look pretty good. I'm not saying that the film's gonna look great. You're gonna compromise so many places along the way, but you made a movie. Now you've got a real conversation with people who are distributors, and with people who finance movies, and people who put out international rights of films. You can call them up, and instead of saying, oh, please make my movie, which they get thousands of those phone calls all day long from people that they don't want to be in business with, and people that they do want to be in business with, and they don't want to make those films anyway. But if you call them up and say, I got a movie, it's sitting in the can, it's finished, I think it's pretty good, they're going to take your phone call, and they're going to watch your movie and have an opinion about it. And you will probably find someone who will say, I'll buy that movie. I'll sell that movie for you. And you're getting into the stream of making and selling movies. And you're a producer. You're a financer. You're a director. You're whatever. Hook up with other people who know how to do it. If you can't find those people, make the movie anyway for nothing. Just make a movie. That's the whole key to this whole business, is make movies.
Got it. Thank you very much.
Hi, my question is, what makes an effective relationship between a director and producer?
Well, that's a really good question. I think that, this is a really good question. Most directors kind of have a pretty good idea of what they want to do. They have a vision of what they want to accomplish, and they have an idea of, they've written a script, or they've developed a screenplay, and they have a real sense of how they're going to get that picture on the screen. Quite often, the directors are, I hate to say this, children. And they got it set in their head how they're going to do it. And then they get set, and they can't see it any other way. And quite often, they write a scene in a script. You say, the scene doesn't work. And that's where you help them in the development process, and really think through how they're going to tell their story from a visual point of view, than just writing it out as a story. And then along the way, in the making of the movie, in the making of the actual picture, you could, if you're an experienced producer, you can say, you know what, you don't really need all this coverage that you're trying to do here. You don't need to go over there in the corner, and then another one over there from that corner, and then another one from over there. You want to, at this moment in the movie, it's like really an emotional moment. I really feel like you need to be close up on the faces. So you can offer somewhat of some advice in the actual making of the film. Most of the time they won't listen to you at all. But where you can be quite effective as a producer with a director is in the post-production phase and watching the films and saying, you know, that scene doesn't work, or that could work better here if it was earlier on, or this scene's too long, or, you know, and being an objective, if it's even possible to be objective at that point, because you've sat and gone through the whole process with them. I think part of it is cheerleading. You know, it's like getting them up in the morning and making sure they're excited about what they're going to do. It's cheerleading with the actors and getting them excited about working with the director so that they're all, you know, excited with each other. And then, you know, there are certain producers, there's certain directors who will never work without certain producers. They'll always work with the same producer over and over and over again. Usually those producers are people who are not combative, but are have an opinion and over the longer period of time making multiple films with each other, their opinions were usually right. So people, you know, it's a collaborative medium to some degree. It's, everyone always says, oh, you know, it's a total collaboration. It's the director's not the guy that made the movie. It's he kind of wanted them. Then it was the actors, and it was the production designer, and it was the editor, whatever. Most of the time, it really is a director, and it's the director trying to figure out how to create a vision and make something that's original. But generally, the producers are trying to help in any way that they can make the movie better.
Thanks.
Hi. Often we learn from our mistakes. I was wondering if you could tell us about one of the mistakes you've made throughout your career and how it affected the film and what you did to overcome it.
Well, that's a really good question. There's so many films. I made so many mistakes along the way, and you learn from each one, and you learn what not to do the next time around. You know, a lot of the early mistakes, quite frankly, for me were, well, here's a good one. The second picture I made was a movie called Nomads. Nomads was a very weird script that I'd read while I was still working at Filmways, and the young director for that movie was a very talented guy who'd never made a movie before, called John McTiernan. And John McTiernan later on did Die Hard, and he became a very successful action director, and then he had some legal problems in the last couple of years, and he's out there wherever he's out there. But in any case, so he was a very talented young writer. He wanted to be a director. And one of the things I convinced my stepfather to do was to take some of the profits that we made from the movie, from Monster Blues, and make another movie with it. So we made this picture. And Pierce Brosnan was the star of it, who is on Remington Steel and wanted to get into the movies. And did you? And Leslie Ann Down was a girl, beautiful English actress that my stepfather always thought was amazing, and we should just get her, even though she wasn't really right for the part. And so we made this movie. When it was done, it was a weird picture. It was definitely an original movie, and it was a strange movie, and it was a psychological thriller, and it's about a guy who's an anthropologist who's kind of following around this. He's a French anthropologist, which Pierce Brosnan is playing a Frenchman, and he's following around this weird group of people in Los Angeles and taking photographs. He's a professor at school, and he's doing an anthropology class on weird people that live on the streets in Los Angeles. And as he gets further and further into their lives, he starts to realize that, in fact, these people aren't really real. They're kind of ghosts, and they're kind of ethereal spirits, and he's now getting and they've actually sucked him in. He thinks he's following them, but they're actually following him, and they start following him back to his home and taking control of his life. And it's a weird movie. Anyway, when it was done, we went around. I did, you know, learn the process of taking films to studios and trying to get them to screen it and see if they would buy it. This is long before I was selling movies myself later on. And we showed it to everyone, and everyone said, no, forget it. It's way too weird. And anyway, Pierce Brosnan's not a movie star, and we're not interested. And Elliot was giving me a really hard time the whole time. It's like, we should never have done this. It was your fault. We shouldn't have made this movie. What a mistake. And so then finally, we're down to, like, we've shown it to everyone. We've shown it to, like, 30 different companies, and we can't get it anywhere. And anyone to bite on it. And finally, we show it to a company that's a foreign sales company called PSO. Doesn't exist anymore, a guy called Mark Damon. And he comes out of the screening and goes, boy, That was a really good pitch, Cassian. That was really well done. That was a terrific movie. I was very excited. I was on the edge of my seat. That's a really good movie. He's a good director. That's, you know, and he starts asking, he has Pierce Brosnan to work with because we're thinking about him for another movie. He's great. And he starts lulling me into this whole conversation. We're sitting in the lobby outside having a coffee after the screening. And he's a big shot movie executive, and I'm like a little, you know, film producer. And he's, we're having this conversation. I can't believe my luck because I can't wait to get on the phone and call out and I've got somebody who wants to buy the movie. Because he says, you know, we'd be interested in buying this picture. We would. I think we would. I think we could do a good job on selling this picture overseas. And we're looking for small pictures like this. I mean, it's a small movie, right? I go, yeah, it was definitely a small movie. Because, God, it had such terrific production value. The, God, it really looked like a much bigger movie. It couldn't have cost you very much. No. It didn't cost us hardly anything. It was really, wow. I mean, God, it looked to me like it cost like about, I don't know, $6 or $7 million. I go, oh, no. It only cost $1 million to make it. He goes, oh, wow, that's incredible, Cass, and that's amazing that you managed to make the film that way. And then we go off and talking about Leslie Ann Dan, and we're talking about whatever, blah, 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 blah. Then at the end of the conversation, he goes, you know what? I'm going to call Elliot now, and I want to make a deal on this picture. And I'm like, oh, my God, this is fantastic. I can't believe my luck. You know, this is brilliant. I'm going to finally get off the bad books with him. And, you know, this my life has been resolved. And because he was putting so much pressure on for months about his film, and the director was going nuts, putting pressure on him, too, and to recut it and rethink it and whatever. And we were going bonkers over this thing. And so then I get a phone call from Elliot. He goes, where are you? You know, I'm at home. Where are you? I'm at MGM. Because, you know, we sold lots of Blues to MGM, and part of the deal that Ellie made, which she hadn't even told me either, was he got a free office for a year from them. And he goes, I'm at MGM. Come and meet me here right away. I go, I got something important to tell you. I go, okay. And I go over there, and I'm parking in the parking lot, and I see him storming across the parking lot. Cassian! Yeah? Come over here. I go, yeah, Elliot, what's up? Did you tell Mark Damon that the film only cost $1 million to make? I go, yeah. You are one of the greatest fucking assholes I've ever met in my entire life. You know what? You know what? I don't know if I even can continue to work with you anymore. You've learned nothing from me. If you can't lie properly, get out of the fucking business. That was a big lesson for me. And I think, you know, the lesson that I got came away. By the way, he bought the movie. Then somebody else bought the American rights. So we all made plenty of money out of this film. And I made another $25,000. But the lesson that you come away from it, and something that I learned so much later on, is you should never discuss the business arrangements of the making of your movie until after you've sold the picture and made business arrangements for it. It's like, just imagine this. Christian Dior, he designs a dress. He goes and he buys all the material for that dress, and it costs him $100 to buy the material. And then he creates this dress, and he sells the dress for $3,000. What was the value of that dress? The value of the dress was what he put into it. It wasn't what the cost of the material was. So the cost of a film doesn't matter. It's the artistic nature that was brought to it by the person that created it, the director and the writers and the producers. And so therefore, it doesn't matter what your movie costs. It's what is it worth to somebody else? What do they think they can do with it? It's a very valuable lesson. And I think it's something that something I carry through the rest of my life, is that you won't really make money out of the films that you're making unless you're very careful about thinking about what the value of that picture becomes later on. And when I say value, is you get more sophisticated in the financing and the thought process of actually putting the financing together of movies. You're thinking all the time about what's the international rights worth for your film. What are you going to sell it in Germany and Spain and France and Italy and Japan? And what are you going to sell it for in America? And what's your tax credit going to be? And you're thinking of the whole financial mechanics of the film. The value of that movie, if it turns out to be a good movie, if it's a terrible movie, it's probably worth what you originally thought it was worth. But if it's a good picture, it's worth a lot more. And there's plenty of sharks out there looking to take advantage of young people, first-time, second-time producers and directors who say, I liked your movie, I'll pay you $100,000 for it. And you think, okay, well, it only costs $100,000. That's a great deal for me. If it's a good movie, it's worth a lot more than that. So the lesson in that is, get people around you who know what they're doing. If you do something good, if you do get a movie made, if you are thinking about how to sell that film, find a lawyer, find a great lawyer, find a sales rep, find people who are very sophisticated in this area, find agents, find managers, whatever it is, and help get them to help you figure out what the value of the picture is and help you sell it. Don't try to do it yourself.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask a question about English Patient movie. Can you tell me about this movie, how you started and...
Oh boy. Well, okay, so that was early on at William Morris, and Saul Zance, who was a wonderful producer. One of my favorite movies when I was growing up as a kid was One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, and he was the producer of that film and won the Oscar for Best Picture for it. And he'd had this project called The English Patient floating around in Hollywood for a long time trying to get it made. And he finally found a wonderful British director who'd done a movie called Truly, Madly, Deeply, I think it was called, and attached him to act in it, and then assembled a pretty good cast. But good young British actor, Ray Fiennes, and they, it was a Julie Binoche, yeah. But the budget was very high. And, you know, they were trying to make it for $28 million was the budget of the film, because it's a period war movie and it's elaborate sets and a lot of traveling around Europe. And also, he wasn't experienced in making low-budget movies. He wanted to make this in the way that he was experienced in making movies. And so he'd gone around, and everybody in town had said no. It's exactly the kind of movie that the studios don't want to make, that nobody wants to make these kinds of movies. And at that time, you know, as I said earlier, Harvey Weinstein was the Wizard of Oz in town, and that was the company that if you're going to make a great independent movie, that's who you wanted to be with. And when I got involved, the agent for the director, who was the client, William Morris was the director, said to me, here's the lay of the land. Everyone said no. There's some soft money coming out of Germany to shoot the movie. There are two companies that seem interested, but they cannot get them off the dime. One is 20th Century Fox, and the other one is Miramax. But they keep like ducking and diving, and saying yes, and then they're saying no. And Anthony McGellar, he's going crazy, and he's going to have this. So he won't look at any other projects. He's been attached to this for a year and a half, and they haven't raised the money. And he's driving me crazy. You've got to get involved, and you've got to help this somehow or other. So that weekend, I was in Spain, and I'd gone to Spain to a film conference there, an independent film conference to go and speak. And at breakfast that morning, there was the keynote speaker for the conference was a guy who was the head of 20th Century Fox at that time, Bill Mechanic. And I didn't really know Bill Mechanic at all. And I saw him sitting there having breakfast with some other students who were chatting him up. And I went and sat down opposite him and started eating my cornflakes. And I said, Bill, you know, do you know this picture called An English Patient? He goes, yeah, I know it very well. He goes, you know, it's way too expensive for what they're trying to do. And it's not going to, you know, they can't do it. I said, well, look, I've gone through the budget with Saul, and we've been talking about it quite a bit. And I knew the budget was 28, but we have a new plan that we could make the movie for 22, I think we were talking about at that time. The director was going crazy on me, and Geller going, we can't cut the budget this way. And I go, yes, you can, because, you know, I made movies for $700,000. To me, $22 million or $23 million was a lot of money. And I said, there is, you know, it's like everyone takes a little bit less and shoot for a few less days. But, you know, you're going to get the movie made and it's going to happen. And, you know, it's not going to talk about it anymore. You're actually going to do it. And there's a way to do it. And I talked to the line producer, and you can cut a week out of this, and you can cut the script by five. And he goes, why aren't you even talking to me about creative things about my script? How dare you tell me to cut 5 pages? And I go, I'm not telling you to do anything. I'm just saying that you could do that. He's like, okay, well, let me think about it. And then they talked about it, and he and Saul, and they were like, yeah. It could be done that way. And so I'm sitting there with Bill Mechanic, and I said, you know, we're thinking about doing it in a slightly different way, and we've got some foreign money, which we had some foreign money, and then some money coming from Germany. And I know they were coming to you, and they were asking you for, I remember the numbers so well now, they were asking you for $11 million, $10.5 million for the American rights for this film. And I think we could, in fact, do it if you only paid us like $7.5 million for the movie. He goes, really? Our numbers show that that would be an okay number for us. I go, so if we could do it that way, would you pay $7.5 million for the film? Yeah. Maybe, yeah, maybe, I said, could win some Oscars. Yeah, we don't give a shit about that. Let me talk to my people and get back to you. So I call up Michael Barretzi, who's a lovely agent at William Morris, who's Minghella's agent. And he says, let's get Mike Simpson on the phone, who was my kind of boss. He was the kind of king of this independent film financing stuff in his head. He was a mathematician, and we'd been, I'd been going through the numbers and telling him how we thought we could do it, and he'd been talking to Harvey Weinstein, trying to lure him in. And I said, Mike, I'm here in Spain, in Madrid, with Bill, and Bill says that he'll do it. We can cut the budget, and he'll do it and pay $7.5 million for the movie. I'm pretty certain he'll do it. He goes, great, I'm going to call Harvey Weinstein right now and tell him that he's losing the movie, that we're closing the deal, and we're going to make it with 20th Century Fox. I hang up, and then I guess 3 hours later, Mike Simpson calls me. He goes, we just closed with Miramax. I go, what? He goes, yeah, I called Harvey, and I told him that we're making the deal with Fox, and we're closing. And literally, 30 minutes later, his lawyer was in my office, and they closed the deal for $8.5 million. And Saul Zantz is so happy, and the movie's getting made, and Saul will go, and Miramax is in, and blah, blah, blah. So it got made because we found a competitor. When you're in that kind of situation where you're the only, I think Harvey was hoping that the movie was never going to happen, and it was just kind of drag on and on and on, and finally he could swoop in at the last minute and get it for nothing. And, that's kind of a game that they all play, and it didn't work on this homie.
Thank you.
Anyway, it won the Oscars.
Yes.
It's a pretty good movie.
Hi, I'm Nikhil. I'm doing the one-year producing program here. Now, for us producers who are starting out, what is the one most important thing that you can tell us that we have to either watch out for, or look out for, or,
you got to know who you're working with. You got to kind of really check out who's line producing your movie. You've got to figure out who you're getting into business with and every level of making movies. So that includes the director that you're going to work with. What's his reputation? What's he done before? Is he talented? The actors that you're going to work with, are they difficult? Are they easy to work with? Are they difficult? Most actors are children on some level too, and you got to. Some of them are more. They're all gifted children, basically. You got to know who you're getting into business with them as well. You've got to understand the deals that you're making with them, with all the people that you're making on the movie. You got to understand what the back ends that they're asking for to make sure that you actually understand what the mathematics are of the deal that you're making. You don't want to end up like, a character out of The Producers, where you sell 138% of the film and it'll give it away before you even start. You want to know who the distributor is that you're getting into business with. What are they actually going to do with your movie when it's done? Which theaters are they going to play it in? How are they going to sell it? How much money are they going to spend on it? I just think you, as a producer, you just have to understand every level of what it is that you're doing. And most of it comes from experience of actually doing it and getting out there and making mistakes along the way, in the way that I have too. I think you really have to understand every aspect of what's going to happen to your movie. Just not just the actual making of that film, who the line producer is, what he's done before, can he bring it in on budget, is the bond going to be in place, is the film going to go over schedule, is the director really got a plan? All the way through, post-production, have we got enough money for the music? Have we got enough money to edit this thing properly? Are we going to actually be ready in time to get the movie into Sundance, or get it into Cannes, or get it into Toronto? Is it going to is who's the buyer for this film? Who are the distributors? What have they distributed before? The ones that come to you and say they're interested, are they really interested? Or are they just trying to buy it because it's a good piece of business for them and they're going to dump it and make money on DVD? There's so many levels. And I know it sounds daunting, but it's part of it is from experience and part of it is from working with people who are experienced to understand every single level of what you're going to do as a filmmaker. Because I think producers are as much filmmakers as the filmmakers on some level because they're actually helping the movie get made. They're making a film.
Thank you, and I love the accent.
Hi. Could you please, in a few words, tell about the projects that you are working right now? And are there any independent films?
I'm working on one with Tova, actually. We're just trying to make the deal for that right now. And it's a thriller called Animal Hour, and she brought me the script, and it's a fantastic script. And I attached a director to it called Courtney Hunt, who I worked on a movie with a couple of years ago called Frozen River. And now we're trying to cast the movie. We're kind of tying our hands behind our back by putting a young actress in it that is not a big star yet. She's a well-known actress. I'm still thinking about whether or not that's going to be work for us or not. So that's something I'm working on at the moment. I'm working on a new movie from... this is kind of boring talking about the things I'm working on in the future, but I...
No, I just mean, do you work on big projects? Or,
oh, yeah, no, I'm working, you know, I work on independent, I make independent movies. I'm an independent filmmaker, and that can range all in kind of different budgets. Literally, there are great independent films like this that were made for under $1 million, and there are great independent movies that are made for $30 million. It really comes down to the kind of film that you're making, the kind of director that you're working with, the kind of level of actors that you're working with, and how much money that movie's worth overseas, and how much is it worth in America, and can you make the movie for less than what you're ultimately going to sell it for? Because that really is the formula. When it really comes down to it, and you really cut through all of this, can you make a movie for less than you're going to sell it for? And I don't mean sell it before you make it, but you've got to have sophisticated people around you who are going to say and be real with you and say, okay, if you make that movie for $5 million, it's going to sell in the foreign marketplace for $4 million. You're going to get $2 million of tax credits. So you're $1 million ahead, maybe. And then you've got America to be the profit. And that way you can go out and raise money from independent financiers. You've got to make films for less than they're worth. Because if you make them for more than they're worth, everybody involved loses money, or the film's never going to happen.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask you something. I remember when you were at William Morris, you always had some rich equity guy around, and you always had sources of money from people. How do you entice those people? What is the formula? What is the magic word that financiers want to hear?
What they really want to hear is how much money they're going to make.
Right.
They want two things. One is this, there's certain different types of financiers. I'll go back. I've worked with them all. Some of them did it because they wanted to put their wife or girlfriend in the movie. Some of them did it because they wanted to be, because they were nerds when they grew up and they wanted to be big shots later on, and now they made lots of money doing something else, but they didn't have any glamour in their life, and so they wanted to add some. And some of them were really just doing it because it's a business deal. And those are the ones, I think, in a way, that are the ones you actually should try to go for. It's not the guy who's putting his wife in it or the people who just want to be in the movie business, because they're going to make odd decisions that they may lose money, and so later on they're going to be mad even though they did it for the other reasons. You're better off being with a financier who actually understands the mechanics of what they're doing and understands the mechanics of what you're doing, and understands why they're making the movie and how much it's going to cost and how much money they could potentially make on the other side if you sell it for the way that you say that you're going to sell it. And then they're looking for people who really know how to sell films and really know how to make them for a price and then sell them for more. And that's how I managed to survive in this business, is because I'm a guy that understands completely how to make a movie, how to finance that movie, and how to get it in the can, how to get actors and directors to want to work with me, work on that movie, and then ultimately sell that movie for more than it was made for. So I've always had the luck of having people who had money that were in my orbit, that I knew that I could go to, and that I understood what films they financed before, what kind of things they were interested in, what kind of deals that they were looking for, what kind of return on their money were they gonna get, and be able to and be a producer. Because the most of them really want to produce movies too. They want to be involved in making films. They just don't want to go through the whole rigmarole of trying to develop a script and get a director and get an actor. They want the action. They want the instant action of being in a deal now. So what I'm trying to do is create packages, because that's what I was taught by William Morris to do, is to create packages of directors and actors and projects and budgets and say, okay, here's one that we could do. It's this director. This is what he's done before. This is the star. This is what they've just done. This is what they're going to be in coming up. These are the hits that they had. These are the failures. This is the foreign sales company that's going to sell the movie. This is what it's worth overseas. This is what I'm going to sell the film for in America. And I've sold so many films here in America that even banks and people that call me up and I have nothing to do with the movies and are asking my advice about, okay, so these people walk through the door and they got this project and they say it's worth $2 million in America. Do you think that movie's worth $2 million in America? I say absolutely not, or yes, 100%. And banks will loan money on estimates that I'm giving for American rights for films because they know that I've sold so many. I know what I'm doing in this arena. So that's what I'm doing with financiers constantly. What I was doing at William Morris and what I continue to do now in my life is bring deals and projects to people who I know have money and match them. It's like being a matchmaker almost. It's like being a dating service. You're saying this director has got this script with this star and it's gonna cost this much and these are the people that are gonna sell it for you overseas and this is the guy that's gonna put in the money against the tax and you're gonna put in this money at the end and we're gonna sell it for more and you're gonna get your money back and this is the profit you're gonna make and also you're gonna be a producer.
I would buy that if I had 2 pennies. Okay, so it's been an hour and a half. My God, we're starting right over. So I want to thank you for an incredible interview. Thanks for coming. Thanks for making us understand the business, independent business, so much better. And you did it in such an entertaining way that I just listened. I didn't even ask questions. Thank you so much.